Hello all, welcome to this video on linear algebra. Today we'll be looking into linear independence, basis and rank. Let's start with the concept of linear combination. Consider a vector space V and a finite number of vectors x1, etc., xk. Then every V element of the vector space of the form V is equal to lambda 1 x1 plus etc. plus lambda k xk is equal to sigma I equal to 1 to k lambda I xi with lambda 1 etc. lambda k elements of real numbers is a linear combination of the vectors x1 etc. xk. The zero vector can always be written as a linear combination of k vectors x1 etc. xk because 0 is equal to sigma I equal to 1 to k, 0 xi is always true. Here we'll be looking into non-trivial linear combination of a set of vectors to represent 0, that is, the linear combination of vectors x1, etc., xk, where not all the coefficients lambda I is 0. Now we'll see what linear independence is. Let us consider a vector space V with k, which is a natural number, and x1, etc., xk are elements of the vector space. If there is a non-trivial linear combination such that 0 is equal to sigma I equal to 1 to k lambda I xi with at least one lambda I not equal to 0, then the vectors x1, etc., xk are linearly dependent. If only the trivial solution exists, that is lambda 1 equal to etc. equal to lambda k which is equal to 0, the vectors x1, etc., xk are linearly independent. Linear independence is one of the most important concepts in linear algebra. Intuitively, a set of linearly independent vectors consists of vectors that have no redundancy. That is, if we remove any of those vectors from the set, we will lose something. A practical way of checking whether the vectors x1, etc., xk are linearly independent is to use Gaussian elimination. First, we write all the vectors as columns of a matrix A and perform Gaussian elimination until the matrix is in row echelon form. All column vectors are linearly independent if and only if all columns are pivot columns. If there is at least one non-pivot column, the columns and therefore the corresponding vectors are linearly dependent. Now we'll see a problem where we are given three vectors and asked to check whether the vectors are linearly dependent. Now for this, we follow the general approach and solve for lambda 1 x1 plus lambda 2 x2 plus lambda 3 x3 to 0, just based on an equation we discussed in the previous slide. Now we'll substitute the values of x1, x2 and x3 with the corresponding vectors. Then we write down the vectors as columns of a matrix and apply elementary transformations until we identify the pivot columns. Following are the transformations done. Second row is subtracted from twice the first row, which gives a 0 here. Then the third row is added with 3 times the first row, which gives a 0 here. Then the fourth row is subtracted from 4 times of the first row, which gives a 0 here. Then we negate the second row and add the fourth row with twice the second row, so we get a 0 here. Then we divide the fourth row by 5 to get 1 here. Then we swap the rows R3 and R4, which is followed by subtracting the fourth row from the 3 times of second row. So we get a 0 here. Then we divide the fourth row by 2, so we get minus 1, which is then added with the third row, so we'll get 0 here. Here we'll see that every column of the matrix is a pivot column. Therefore, there is no non-trivial solution and we require that lambda 1 equal to 0, lambda 2 equal to 0 and lambda 3 is equal to 0 to solve the equation system. Hence, the vectors x1, x2, x3 are linearly independent. Now we consider a vector space V with k linearly independent vectors v1, v2, etc., vk and m linear combinations as given here. then we are defining B, which is B1, B2, etc., BK, as the matrix whose columns are the linearly independent vectors B1, B2, etc., BK, just given as xj is equal to b into lambda j, where lambda j consists of lambda 1j to lambda kj, where j weight is from 1 to m, which is a more compact form. We want to test whether x1, etc., xm are linearly independent. For this purpose, we will follow the general approach of testing whether sigma j is equal to 1 to m, psi j, xj is equal to 0. We are using another scalar psi instead of lambda because lambda is already used to represent the value of xj. On substituting the value of xj with this, we get sigma j is equal to 1 to m, psi j, b into lambda j. Now b is the matrix we have, so we are taking it out and write it as b into sigma j is equal to 1 to m, psi j, lambda j. This means that x1, etc., xm are linearly independent if and only if the column vectors lambda 1, etc., lambda m are linearly independent. In a vector space V, m linear combinations of k vectors x1, etc., xm are linearly dependent if m is greater than k. Now we'll consider a set of linearly independent vectors b1, b2, b3, b4 and check whether the vectors x1, x2, x3 and x4 are linearly independent. For this we need to check whether the column vectors are linearly independent. For that we convert them into a matrix and perform elementary transformations as given here. The second row is added to twice the first row to give 0 here. Then the third row is subtracted from the first row to give a 0 here. Then we add the fourth row and the first row to give 0 here. Just followed by adding first and the third row to give a 0 here. Then the first row is subtracted from the fourth row to give 0 here. Just followed by adding 3 times of the third row with the fourth row, which gives us this result. Now R2 is added with 7 times of R4, so we will get a 0 here. Then the second row is divided by 10, giving these values. Then we negate the second row and add R3 with minus 10 times of R4, we get the following result. Then we divide the fourth row by 12 to get this result. Then R4 is subtracted from R2. So we get this matrix. From this, R3 is subtracted from 12 times of R2, giving this result. In this, the third row is divided by 10, giving the following result. As the final transformation, we'll be negating the third row so that the identity matrix here will have no negative values in it. We see that the corresponding linear equation system is non-trivially solvable. The last column is not a pivot column. And x4 can be written as minus 7x1, minus 15x2, minus 18x3. Therefore, x1, etc., x4 are linearly dependent since x4 can be expressed as a linear combination of x1, x2 and x3. Now, we'll discuss the concept of groups. Consider a set G and an operation tensor product G cross G to G, defined on the set G. Then group G is equal to set G followed by the tensor product operator, which is called a group if the following hold. The closure of set G under the tensor product, that is for all X and Y elements of the set G, tensor product of X and Y also belong to the set G. Associativity for all x, y, z, which are element of the set G. Tensor product of x and y, followed by the tensor product of its result and z, will be equal to the tensor product of x and the result of tensor product of y and z. The neutral element, there exists an element E which belongs to the set G for all x which again belong to the set G in such a way that when we do the tensor product of x and E, we get the value x. Similarly, when we perform the tensor product of E and x, we get the value x. Then we have the inverse element, that is for all x element of the set G, there exists a y which is another element of G, such that the tensor product of x and y gives us the element E. Again, the tensor product of y and x will give us the element E, where E is the neutral element. We'll often write x inverse to denote the inverse of the element x. If additionally, for all x, y elements of the set G, if the tensor product of x, y is equal to the tensor product of y and x, then the group G is equal to the set G followed by the tensor product operator is an abelian group, since it satisfies the commutative property. Now we looked at sets G and the inner operators on the set G, that is the mapping G cross G to G that only operate on the elements in G. We'll now consider the set that in addition to an inner operation plus, that will also contain an outer operation dot, which stands for the multiplication of a vector x, which is an element of set G, by a scalar lambda, which is a real number. We can think of the inner operation as a form of addition and the outer operation as a form of scaling. Now we'll see the definition for a vector space. A real valued vector space V is equal to set V followed by the plus operator and the dot operator is a set V with two operations, where plus is mapped from V cross V to V and dot operator is mapped from R cross V to V, where set V followed by the plus operator is an abelian group. Also, it satisfies the property of distributivity, that is, for all lambda, which is a real number, for x and y elements of the set V, lambda dot x plus y gives lambda dot x plus lambda dot y. For all lambda and psi, which are real numbers, for every x, which is an element of set V, lambda plus psi dot x is equal to lambda dot x plus psi dot x. Then comes the associativity property on the outer operation. For all lambda psi, which are real numbers, x an element of the set V, lambda dot psi dot x is equal to lambda dot psi dot x. The neutral element with respect to the outer operation, that is for all x element of the set V, 1 dot x is equal to x. Now the elements x of the set V are called vectors. The neutral element of set V followed by the plus operator is a zero vector as given here. The inner operation plus is called vector addition. The elements lambda, which are real numbers, are called scalars, and the outer operation dot is a multiplication by scalars. Now let us move on to see what is a generating set. Consider a vector space V consisting of set V, plus operator and dot operator, and a set of vectors A which consist of x1, etc., xk. If every vector V, which is an element of set V, can be expressed as a linear combination of x1, etc., xk, then A is called the generating set of V. The set of all linear combination of vectors in A is called span of A and denoted by this symbol. Now let us move on to see what basis is. Consider a vector space V where it consists of the set V, plus operator and dot operator, and we have generating set A which is subset or equal to the set V. A generating set A of vector space V is called minimal if there exists no other smaller set A dash which is subset or equal to A, which is again subset or equal to set V, that spans V vector space. Every linearly independent generating set of vector space V is minimal and is called a basis of V. Every vector space V will possess a basis B. There can be many bases of a vector space V. That is, there is no unique basis. However, all bases possess the same number of elements, that is the basis vectors. Bases can be found by executing the following step. As the first step, we write the spanning vectors as columns of a matrix A. In the second step, we determine the row echelon form of A. In the final step, the spanning vectors associated with the pivot columns are the basis, which is obtained as the result. Now we'll see a problem where we are given a vector subspace U spanned by vectors x1, x2, x3 and x4, for which we should find which of these vectors are a basis for the subspace U. Now for this we need to check whether x1, x2, etc, x4 are linearly independent. For this we need to solve sigma I is equal to 1 to 4, lambda I xi is equal to 0, which leads to a homogeneous system of equations with matrix as given here. Then we perform the basic elementary transformations on this to convert it into row echelon form. The second row is subtracted from twice the first row to give 0 here. Then the third row is added to the first row to give 0 here. Then the fourth and the first rows are added to give a 0 here. Fifth row and first row is added to give a 0 here. Then the second row is multiplied by 5, which gives us this result. Then the third row is divided by 3 since all its elements are multiples of 3. Then the second and the third rows are added to give 0 here. Then we swap the second and the fourth rows. Then we subtract R2 from 4 times of R3, which will give us 0 here. Then we swap R2 and R3, which gives us the final matrix here. Since the pivot columns indicate which of these vectors are linearly independent, we see from the row echelon form that x1, x2 and x4 are linearly independent because the system of linear equations can be solved only if lambda 1, lambda 2 and lambda 4 are 0. Therefore, x1, x2, x4 is a basis of U. Now we will see what rank is. The number of linearly independent columns of a matrix A equals the number of linearly independent rows and is called rank of A and is denoted by RK of A. Now we'll find the rank of the following matrix A. For this, we apply the Gaussian elimination and do the following transformation, which is second row is added to twice the first row, which gives a 0 here. Then the third row is subtracted from 3 times the first row, which gives 0 here. Then we add the second and the third row, which gives us the final matrix. Here we see that the number of linearly independent rows and columns is 2, such that rank of A is equal to 2. That's all for now. Thank you for watching.